Hello everyone, so in this particular lecture we are going to analyze the certified copies of November 2019 SFM paper, which is my attempts paper, and this is my certified copy, so that I can help you all in presenting the answers in the expected manner which the examiner is expecting in the examination. Okay, in this particular lecture what I would be doing, I would be solving the November 2019 paper. I would be comparing the suggested answers with my particular answer sheet so that you can analyze what are the marks allotted to each step, and it would help all of you to present your answers in better manner. Okay, so let's begin with question number 3 first. I will be moving with those questions which I have solved first in the examination. Let's solve question number 3 first. EB Limited's equity shares are presently selling at a price of ₹500. An investor is interested in purchasing EB Limited shares. The investor expects that there is a 70% chance that the price will go up to ₹650 or a 30% chance that it will go down to ₹450 3 months from now. There is a call option on the shares of the firm that can be exercised only at the end of 3 months at an exercise price of ₹550. This is the strike price of the option. We are expected to do, we are required to calculate, if the investor wants a perfect hedge, what combination of the share and option should he select? Okay, then explain how the investor will be able to maintain identical position regardless of the share price. If the RF is 5% for the 3 months period, underline this particular sentence very carefully. 5% is the interest rate for the 3 months period. What is the value of the option at the beginning of the period? And finally, what is the expected return on the option? This is an easy question if you understand the concept quite well. First, we would compute the hedge ratio. The formula for computing hedge ratio is what? C1 minus C2 whole upon S1 minus S2. C1 is the gain which we would get if the call option is exercised, which is 650 minus 550. So 100 has been calculated as 650 minus 550. Minus C2. C2 is the gain which we would get if the call option is expired worthless, that is 0. Whole upon S1 minus S2, which is 650 and 450 given in the question. Therefore, the hedge ratio is 0.5. This means that the investor should purchase 0.5 share for every one call option. This is the interpretation of the hedge ratio. Remember, in hedging, if you are long the security, that is if you have bought the security, you need to go short the call option. Okay. Next question asked us how the investor will be able to maintain his position if he purchases 0.5 share for one call option return. Okay, he is purchasing 0.5 shares and he is writing one call option. Okay, if the price of share goes up to ₹650, then what would be the value of the purchase share? It would be nothing but 650 multiplied by 0.5. Why 0.5? Because we have taken 0.5 shares and not one particular share. So 650 multiplied by 0.5 would be 325. We would also incur a loss on account of short position, because the holder of the option would exercise the option as the exercise price of 550 is lesser than the market price of 650. Understand, the holder of the call option would think that instead of going in the market and buying the share at 650, I would exercise the option and buy the share at ₹550. Therefore, I would have to incur a loss on account of short position of ₹100. And the net value of the portfolio after 3 months would be 225. Similar analysis can be done for the next subpart. If the price of share comes down to 450, then value of purchase share would be how much? It is nothing but 450 multiplied by 0.5, which is 225. This is the value of portfolio after 3 months. The call option would expire worthless because the holder of the call option would not exercise it, as the exercise price of 550 is more than the market price of 450. And instead of exercising the call option, the holder of the option would buy the share in the market rather than exercising the call option. Next, we are required to calculate the value of option, say P. Okay, we have to calculate the value of option. This is an important statement over here. This is an important calculation. See, what they have done, they have simply equated the value of portfolio 3 months from now from the value of portfolio today. Okay, instead of writing this like this, I would write it in a different way. I would write it as follows. The value of portfolio after 3 months is what? 225. The present value would be how much? Whole upon 1.05, discounting it at 5% per annum, 5% for 3 months period. This is the present value of portfolio. I would equate this with the value of portfolio today. How much is the share price? The share price is 500, which is given in the question. If you see the question, the share price is ₹500. See, ₹500 each. This is the share price. Therefore, the value of portfolio today is 500 into 0.5, which is 250, minus the premium which I am going to pay if I buy the option. Okay, this is the value of the portfolio today, and therefore the value of premium is nothing but 35.7. Okay, I had made a mistake in this particular question. My mistake was that I multiplied 0.5 by 3 and divided it by 12, considering that 5% is for per annum and not for 3 months. This is how I was able to lose 3 marks in this particular question, because the next question was dependent on the previous question, and therefore as per this analysis, I think that even if your first question is wrong and the second answer is dependent on the first answer, I think you are going to lose marks if your first answer is itself wrong, because the value which you are going to take in the second question is nothing but the value which you have computed in the first question. Okay, fourth question asks us to calculate the expected return on the option. Okay, remember this is always from the point of view of investor. Okay, investor's point of view. So for an investor, what would be the return? It would be the expected value of the option, that is the gain which he would get if he exercises the option, minus the premium, whole upon the premium. Premium is nothing but the initial investment multiplied by 100. Expected option value is 650 minus 550 into 0.7 plus 0 into 0.3. Why 0 into 0.3? Because if the call option is exercised worthless, then the value of gain would be 0. However, if the share price moves to 650, there would be a gain of 100, but there is only a 70% probability. Therefore, the expected value of option is 100 into 0.7, which is rupees 70. And thus, the expected rate of return is 70 minus 35.71, which is the value of premium, whole upon the premium, into 100, which is 96.02%. Okay, I hope you have understood this question. Let me take you to my suggested answers, how I had presented this question in my answer sheet itself. So first I wrote the formula of hedge ratio C1 minus C2 whole upon S1 minus S2, which is 0.5. Then I wrote the interpretation, he should purchase 0.5 shares for every short on call option. Then if the price of the share goes to 650, the value of share would be 650 to 0.5, 325, less loss on account of short position, which is 100, which would give me the value of portfolio. If the price goes to 450, there would be no loss on short position, and the value of share would be 450 to 0.5, which is 225. See, I have written over here, the holder of the call option won't exercise the call as the market price is lesser than the exercise price. Computing the value of call option, this is the mistake which I had made. See, I had multiplied it by 3 and divided it by 12. Despite the fact that I had written this particular assumption that the risk-free rate is assumed to be 5% per annum. Despite the fact that I wrote this assumption, I lost 3 marks. I lost 2 marks in this question and I lost 1 mark in the next sub-question. Therefore, it is very important that even if you are writing an assumption, the examiner is going to check the answer based on the model answers which he is getting. Despite the fact that this is right as per the assumption which I have written, I was not able to score a single mark in this particular question. And resultantly, the next question was dependent on the sub-question 3 and I lost a mark over here as well. I only got 1 mark because of this calculation of rupees 70. 27.78 was the wrong value. This was 35.71 as per the calculation. And therefore, I did not score 1 mark over here. This is how I lost 3 marks in this question. If I would have assumed this as 5% for 3 months period, I think I would have scored 8 out of 8 marks. Okay. I hope this particular question and questions analysis is useful for all of you. So remember that you have to solve every question very carefully. Let's see the next sub question, which is part B. Okay. Closing values of BSE Sensex are given. Okay, this is simple. You just have to calculate the exponential moving average. The 30-day exponential moving average is 35,000. The exponent value is 0.064. You just have to provide an analyzed conclusion on the basis of your calculations. This is quite simple. You simply have to use the formula which is given in the module. You have to substitute these values to get the answer. I would quickly show you how I had presented this particular question in my answer sheet. This is same as per the suggested answers, and therefore I was able to score 8 out of 8 marks in this question. See, first I wrote the formula of EMA, which is closing price of BSE Sensex minus previous day EMA multiplied by the exponent plus previous day EMA. Okay, so the closing price I had written in column 1. I subtracted the previous day EMA from the closing price, multiplied it by the exponent to get the amount, and I added this to the previous day EMA to get the final EMA. This is how I had written. This is exactly which is presented in the module also. If you read this chapter from the module, this is a question from test your knowledge section, and therefore I was able to write all the answers correctly. Okay, we also have to provide an analyzed conclusion. If you see, for the first 2 days, the EMA is going down. However, for the last 4 days, it is going up. and based on this particular trend, it is assumed that it is going on an upward trend except on the first 2 days, and therefore the market is showing a bullish trend, okay, as the EMA is on an average in an increasing trend. I was very clear enough in presenting my answers, as I had written that except on the first 2 days, it is on a decreasing trend. However, for the last 4 days, it is on an increasing trend, and thus the market appears to be bullish. Okay. Last question. What is a startup to avail the benefits of a government scheme? Here you simply had to write what is a startup. This is given in the chapter Startup Finance. I would quickly show you how they have given in the suggested answers, so that we can compare my suggested answers with the certified copy answers. Okay. See, the startup scheme was initiated by the government on 16th of January 2016. It was initiated on 16th of January 2016. The definition of startup was provided, which is applicable only in case of government schemes. Okay, so not prior to 5 years. Then next, with annual turnover not exceeding 25 crores, innovation, development and deployment or commercialization, and there's also one more point. It shall be eligible for tax benefits only if it has obtained certification from the interministerial board set up for such purpose. Okay, this is the answer given in suggested answers. I would tell you that my answer was not exactly the same as the suggested answer, but still I was able to score 4 out of 4 marks in this question as well. First, I wrote the definition of startup as per the original notification. See, here I have made an error. If you see, 1st June 2016. Actually, the date was not 1st June 2016. Instead, it was 16th Jan 2016. Despite this error which I had made in my examination, still the examiner ignored this particular error because he knew that I have written everything up to the mark for the rest of the bullet points, and ignoring this error, I was still able to score 4 out of 4 marks, see, in this question as well. So I have underlined the keywords, and this is, it is very important for all of you to underline the keywords which are there so that the examiner does not have to read the entire answer, and he can read whatever are the keywords which you have underlined, so that it saves his time as well as it secures good marks for all of you. Okay, so turnover of not more than 25 crores, then the benefit of startup would be available for the first 5 years. Entity should be engaged in the innovation and development or investment in technology, and it shall not be formed by splitting up or reconstruction or by demerger. These were the 4 points which I had written in my examination answer sheet, and still I was able to score 4 out of 4 marks, despite the fact that I had made an error as the launch date was not 1st June, but in fact it was 16th of January. Okay. So I hope this particular question was clear to all of you. Let's solve question number 2 now. Question number 2 from the suggested answers. Okay. This is a mutual fund question. This is an old course practice manual question. See, there are 3 plans. Plan A, Plan B, Plan C. Okay. Plan A is a dividend reinvestment plan. Plan B is a bonus plan. And Plan C is a growth plan. The initial value is rupees 2 lakh of investment of all the 3 investors. And the face value is rupees 10 per unit. The dividend percentage is given, the bonus ratio is given. On 31st July 2019, all the 3 investors redeemed all the balance units. Long-term capital gains tax is exempt. Short-term capital gains tax is subject to 10%. STT is 0.2%. We have to ignore cess. We are required to calculate the effective yield per annum of each of the investors and to suggest the name of the investor with the highest effective yield per annum. This is also a simple question if you are very good with all your calculations which you are showing in the answer sheet. Let's solve this particular question. For Mr. Arun, the plan A is dividend reinvestment plan. In a dividend reinvestment plan, what happens is that the dividend which you get, they are converted into the units based on the net asset value prevailing on the date on the receipt of dividend. Okay. So initial investment is of rupees 2 lakh and the NAV is 10, that is face value. Therefore, the number of units are 20,000. You have to add the number of units to this opening units to get the closing units. Now the dividend payout ratio for 31st July 2013 was 10%. Therefore the dividend is how much? 2 lakh into 10%, which is 20,000. Dividing this by the NAV prevailing on 31st July 2013 gives me the additional units which Mr. A is going to receive. And adding 651 to 20,000 gives me the balance of closing units. Okay. Now on 31st March 2014, the dividend payout ratio is 35. I'll just explain you how this 72,280.15 value has come. If you see the closing units are 20,651.47. So 20,651.47 multiplied by 10, which is the face value, multiplied by 35%, which is the dividend payout ratio. So this is 72,280. Okay, and this is how 72,280 has come. Dividing this by the NAV prevailing on 31st March 2014 gives me the additional units. I have to add this to 20,651 to get the closing units. Okay, this is how all the calculation is done. The redemption value is nothing but the closing units multiplied by the NAV prevailing on 31st July 2019. We have to subtract the securities transaction tax of 0.2% to get the net amount received. We have to subtract the short-term capital gains tax at the rate of 10% on 978.94 multiplied by 53.64 minus 48.1. Here you can also subtract 48.1 from 53.75 itself. Okay, because the deduction of securities transaction tax is not available as per 7th proviso to section 48 of the Income Tax Act, and therefore I had taken 53.75 as the value and not 53.64. You get the net of tax value. You have to subtract the investment to get the return. This is for a period of 124 months. If you calculate it, it is for a period of 124 months, and therefore the annual average return is how much? 11,14,905 whole upon 2 lakh multiplied by 12 divided by 124. This is the annual average return. Let's solve for the bonus plan. Initial units were 20,000. Bonus is declared in into the ratio of 5:4, 1:3, and 1:4. You simply have to multiply 20,000 by 5 and divide by 4. 20,000 into 5 by 4 is 25,000. Adding it to 20,000 gives me the total balance of 45,000 units. This NAV column is irrelevant. It is not at all useful for all of us. Only the closing NAV is useful, okay? Again, 45,000 into 1 by 3 gives me 15,000. Adding this to 45,000 gives me 60,000. 60,000 into 1 by 4 gives me 15,000. Adding this to 60,000 gives me the closing units of 75,000. The redemption NAV is 22.98, which is given in the question. We have to subtract the STT, we have to subtract the short-term capital gains tax of 10%, and we get the net of tax value. Again, the return has to be computed for a period of 12 months, and this return has to be multiplied by 12 and divided by 124 to get the effective yield per annum. Okay. An important part in this question is about the short-term capital gains tax of 10%. For the short-term capital gains tax, remember in the direct tax provisions, capital gains tax is liable only if the security is sold within a period of 12 months. So this security was sold within a period of 12 months. If you see that on 25th March 2019, this particular security was bought and it was sold on 31st July 2019. Therefore, it was sold within a period of 12 months and thus it is liable to short-term capital gains tax. If you see, this 15,000 is nothing but this 15,000 bonus units. I hope this is clear to all of you. And 19.95 is the NAV which is prevailing on 25th March 2019. Okay. I hope this is clear to all of you. The annual return can be multiplied by 12 and divided by 124 to get the effective yield per annum. And for Plan C, it is the simplest of all. You just have to multiply the redemption NAV by 20,000, subtract the STT. There will be no short-term capital gains tax as more than 12 months has passed. And the net gain can be computed. This can be divided by 2 lakh, multiplied by 12, divided by 124 to get the effective yield per annum. You can just write Mr. Amit earns the highest effective yield per annum of 73.33%, and the difference to his nearest investor is 3.74. This is how you would be able to fetch 10 out of 10 marks in this particular question. See, they have also given a note, Proviso 5 of Section 48 of IT Act. Okay, this proviso is wrong. As per the amendment made by the Finance Act 2018, this has become Proviso 7, not Proviso 5. So I had written in my answer sheet as Proviso 7 itself, and I was able to score 10 out of 10 marks in this question as well. Let's see how I have calculated the answers to this particular question. It is similar to the ones given in the answer sheet. Opening units, dividend, divide dividend by the NAV to get the additional units. Add this to the opening units to get the closing units. Okay, I was able to calculate all the closing units. The redemption value was multiplied by the redemption NAV, subtract the STT to get the net of tax value, subtract STCG, and just subtract it from the investment to calculate the effective yield per annum. Okay, if you see, there are markings for each step, 1, 1, 1. Okay, so there is a marking for each and every step. For Mr. Amit, I simply calculated the bonus units, and in the answer sheet, if you see, the redemption NAV was also given, and all the NAVs were given. There was a separate column. I told you that is not needed at all. I did not draw that column. I simply calculated the bonus units, added it to the opening units to get the closing units. Okay. Redemption value less STT less STCG to get the total investment, to total return, subtract it from the initial investment to get the effective yield per annum. And for Mr. Rashi, it is the same, redemption amount minus STT, and the return is computed accordingly. See, I had specifically written this in the answer sheet, that as per the 7th proviso to section 48 of ITC of Income Tax Act, the amount of STT has not been considered while calculating the STCG. Okay, because it is not allowed as a deduction. I wrote the highest effective yield per annum. I wrote the nearest investor. The difference was 3.74% per annum. I hope this particular question's presentation is clear to all of you. Okay, let's see what is question number 2B. Okay, this is a very easy question. I would directly show you my certified copy, because I've written the same as they have done in their suggested answers. A future contract is available on R Limited that pays an annual dividend of rupees 4 and whose stock is currently priced at 125. 1000 shares is one future contract. The rate of interest is 8% prevailing in the market. What is the price of one future contract? If the stock price decreases by 6%, what will be the price of one futures contract? And what would be the resultant gain or loss if an investor has taken a long position? Okay, this is a fairly very easy question. I would quickly show you my suggested answers. Futures price is nothing but spot plus cost of carry minus dividend. The price of the security is 125. We have to add the cost of carry, which is the carrying cost of the inventory, that is 125 into 8%, that is the opportunity cost, and subtract the dividend. You are not buying the security, therefore you are not going to receive the dividend which you would have received if you would have bought the security separately. Subtract 4 from the cost of carry, multiply this by 1000 to get the price of one futures contract. Now, if the stock price decreases by 6%, new stock price is what? 125 minus 6%, which is 117.5, and therefore the price of futures now is, this, applying the same formula, you just have to substitute 125 by 117.5 to get the price of the futures contract. Here I had written an assumption that since it is not given as to when the stock price changes, it is assumed that the stock price changes immediately, and thus the whole year's cost of carry and dividend has been taken into consideration. For instance, if the price of the security would have changed after 6 months, we would have taken only 6 months interest and 6 months dividend. And therefore, I have written this particular assumption in order to not lose marks in this question. What would be the loss for an investor having a long position? The loss is nothing but subtraction of both the answers computed in subpart 1 and subpart 2. An investor having a long position in futures will tend to lose, as he will have to cancel his position by selling the futures at a lower amount. And therefore, the amount of loss is 8,100. See, I was able to score 6 on 6 in this question. 2 marks for this question, 2 marks for subpart 2, and 2 marks for subpart 3. See, understand, 1 mark is given for this statement also. So I think you should highlight this. An investor having a long position will tend to lose, as he will have to cancel his position by selling the futures at a lower amount. If I wouldn't have had written this, I think I would have scored only 1 out of 2 marks in this subpart 3, and I would have lost 1 mark. Okay, this is very important. Let's see what is the theory question. Identify the benefits of securitization from the angle of originator. This is also a very easy question. I would quickly show you how I had written this in my answer sheet. First, I wrote the definition of securitization. It is the process of repackaging and rebundling of illiquid securities into marketable securities. Okay, next I wrote the advantages. If you see, I have written the main bullet points which were there in the suggested answers, mainly the off-balance sheet financing, the specialization in main business, the next advantage being helps improve the financial ratios. And last advantage was something different. It was not a regulatory requirement. If you see the suggested answers, the last advantage was reduced borrowing cost. I did not write this particular advantage in my certified copy, but still I was able to score 4 out of 4 marks in this particular question. Why? Because my presentation was neat and clean. I was able to explain all the above 3 bullet points very nicely. I had also underlined the key main points, provides the originator immediate funds, and the illiquid assets are removed. It can focus more on its core activities. Okay, in case of banks, the capital to weighted assets ratio improves significantly. So I'd underline these keywords, and therefore I was able to score 4 out of 4 marks in this question as well. Okay, despite the fact that I did not write the last advantage correctly, this is incorrect, but still I was able to score 4 on 4 marks. Okay, remember that even if you're writing something incorrect, The examiner would not deduct all your marks, but then if you have written what he's expecting, at least in the first three bullet points, I think he's going to give you 4 out of 4 marks. So by this analysis, I think it is clear to all of you that ICAI does not give negative marking. It would give you full marks even if you have written something incorrect at the end, provided that you have written everything up to the mark in your first answers. Okay, I hope this is useful for all of you. Let's move on to the next sub question. Question number 5. Okay, let's solve question number 5 now. Yeah, X holds the following portfolio: equity shares A limited, B limited, C limited, PSU bonds. The RF is 12%. The expected rate of return. Okay, we have to compute the expected rate of return using the KPM, that is capital asset pricing model, and we have to compute the average return. I would again show you my certified copies, which are same as the suggested answers, so that you can have an idea of how to present this in the examination. Many of the authors say that this answer is wrong given by the institute, but the crux here is that it is assumed by ICAI that only these securities are there in the market as well. Therefore, once we are computing the return of these securities, we are calculating the return on market portfolio, which is 15.88%. How did we calculate this? We simply added the dividend and capital gains, which was given in the question, to calculate the total return. Divide this by the initial investment of 1,36,000 to get the return, which is 15.88%. Remember that this 15.88% is the return of the market portfolio, and this is not the average return which is required to be calculated in subpart 2. Okay, expected return is what? RF plus beta into RM minus RF. RF is 12%, beta is given for individual securities in the question, RM is 15.88 and RF is 12. So we get the expected return as per the capital asset pricing model. In the next sub question, we are simply asked to calculate the average return. Since in the practice manual, simple average was calculated, even I was just assuming that the model answers are coming from the practice manual, and therefore I also calculated the simple average, which comes out to 14.619%. But what I did, I also wrote an alternative answer computing the weighted average. I wrote that alternatively, a weighted average of the above returns can also be computed based on market value as the weights. And in that case, the answer would be 14.227. I did not show the calculations, but I was quick enough to calculate it on my calculator, and I just wrote it separately in case the examiner is having a model answer which contains weighted average and not the simple average. Logically speaking, a weighted average should be computed because the investment in every security was given, and I think 14.227% is the correct answer. However, they have not given this answer in their suggested answers. They have only considered this answer in the suggested answers, which is nothing but the old course practice manual answers. Again, by this analysis, I think that the institute is taking out its model answers from the answers given in the old course practice manual. Therefore, it becomes very important for all of you to write the answers based on the answers given in PM. Write the answers as per PM or the SM. That is material issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. This is the advice which I would like to give all of you. Okay, let's see question number 5, subpart B. This is also same old course PM question. I would quickly run through the solution. Let's read the question first. A multinational company is planning to set up a subsidiary in India. The initial project cost is $500 million. The net working capital requirement is $100 million. Until now, it has been exporting 2 million units every year at a unit price of $100, and the VC per unit is $50. Okay, the depreciation is followed using straight line method. If the subsidiary set up in India, these would be the additional information. Variable cost would be 25 per unit. Additional cash fixed cost would be $40 per annum. Then the sales capacity would be 5 million units. The expected life is 5 years. The expected existing working capital investment for production and sale is $20 million. Export of the product will decrease to 1.5 million units in case the company does not open subsidiary company in India. In view of the presence of competing MNCs that are in process of setting up their subsidiaries in India, this information is given in order to subtract it from the additional cash flows generated from setting up the subsidiary in India. Why? Because this is the opportunity cost. If you would not have set up a subsidiary in India, you would have exported the products, and therefore this revenue you would have realized if you would not have had set up a subsidiary in India. The corporate tax rate is 30%, the required rate of return is 12%. Estimate the net present value of the proposed project in India. I would quickly show you how I had solved this question in my suggested answers. It is the same as given in my certified copy as compared to the suggested answers. First, compute the initial project cost, which is 500 the initial project cost of plant and machinery plus the working capital of 100 given in the question, less release of the existing working capital. This is an inflow for us, which is 20, and therefore the initial outflow is 580. Let's calculate additional cash inflows in India through setting up the subsidiary. The selling price per unit is given as 100. Subtract the variable cost per unit. This becomes the contribution per unit. Multiplied by 5 million units to get the total contribution. Subtract the cash fixed cost. Subtract the depreciation. Depreciation is 500 upon 5, which is the initial project cost whole upon the estimated life. This gives me the earnings before tax. Subtract tax to get the earnings after tax. Add back the depreciation because depreciation is a non-cash expense. To get the cash flow for 5 years per annum. Okay, this is the cash flow for 5 years per annum. There would also be a cash flow at the end of 5th year, which is nothing but the release of working capital, which is 100 minus 20, that is 80. Okay, this is 100 minus 20, that is 80. And next, we would calculate what would be the inflows had the subsidiary not been opened from the exports. The selling price is 100, variable cost is 50, which is given in the first paragraph of the question. Multiply by the number of units to get the profit. Subtract the tax, that is 30%, assuming that 30% tax rate is there in the company, in the country in which the company is incorporated, to get the cash flow from exporting. See, I have written a note separately. It is assumed that the tax rate of the country in which the company is incorporated is also 30%. Okay, and therefore the additional cash flows from setting up subsidiary would be 264.5, which we have computed. Subtract 52.5 from 264.5 to get 212 million. These are the additional cash flows. And therefore, what is the net present value? It is nothing but present value of cash inflows, which is 212 multiplied by present value annuity factor for 5 years plus 80 multiplied by the present value factor of 5th year to get the total present value of cash inflows. Subtract the present value of cash outflow, which is 580, to get the net present value. Since the net present value is positive, the company should set up a subsidiary in India. Okay, look at the markings. They have given each and every mark for present value of inflow, for present value of outflow, for the net present value, and even for the conclusion. Okay, if you look at the markings, they are giving marks as per the details and as per the steps which you have written in your answer. Okay, let's look at the theory question. Discuss briefly the key decisions which fall within the scope of financial strategy. I have covered this lecture in our Unacademy class as well, that the four decisions are what? Financial, portfolio, dividend, and investment. Once you write these keywords, you can explain these decisions in your own words, and I think you would be able to score 4 out of 4 marks. Okay, in this, I have only written the keywords and I had explained this in my own words. See, financing decision is what? Debt to equity ratio, and it is all about the capital structure of the company. Investment decision is what? Whether a particular project should be taken or not by the company. Whether a company should incur capital expenditure or not. Dividend decision is what? Whether it should give dividend to the shareholders or it should reinvest for better growth prospects. And lastly, portfolio decisions, meaning that the investment should be looked as a whole and not individually. This is all the decisions which I had written, and still I was able to score 4 out of 4 marks, despite the fact that I did not explain in practice manuals or the study materials language, but I had written those 4 keywords, namely financing, dividend, investment, and portfolio, so that the examiner knew that I had studied this particular chapter. Let's look on to the move on to question number 1 now. Question number 1. E Limited, a listed company, is considering merger of B Limited, which is also a listed company, with itself by means of a stock swap exchange. Okay, B Limited has agreed to a plan under which A Limited will offer the current market value of B Limited shares. The data of A Limited and B Limited is given, namely the EAT, number of shares, and the current market price per share. We are required to calculate what would be the pre-merger EPS and P ratio. If B Limited's P is 10, what is the current market price per share? What is the exchange ratio? What will A Limited's post-merger EPS be? What must the exchange ratio be for A Limited's pre-merger and post-merger EPS to be the same? I would quickly show you how I had written this answer in my certified copy. This was same and similar to the one given in the practice manual and in the suggested answers as well. Divide the number of shares and the earnings after tax to get the earnings per share of 2.5 and 1.25. Divide the market price by the earnings per share to get the P ratio, which is 20 and 16 times. This was very easy. Secure 2 out of 2 marks. Calculate the market price of B Limited, assuming that the P ratio is 10 and the EPS is 1.25, which we have computed in subpart 1, to get the market price as rupees 12.5 per share. Assuming that the market price of B Limited is 12.5, then A Limited will issue shares worth the market value of B Limited, which is what? 12.5 multiplied by 2 lakh shares, which are number of shares of B Limited. So the total amount to be issued is rupees 25 lakh, simply divide 25 lakh by the number of by the market price per share of A Limited, which is 50, to get the total number of shares to be issued to B Limited. And therefore, the share exchange ratio would be 50,000 is to 2 lakh, which is 0.25 is to 1, that is 1 is to 4. This can also be computed directly as to the exchange ratio based on the market prices of both the company, which is 12.5 is to 50, which is 1 is to 4. Okay, this is the exchange ratio. And next subpart, okay, we have to calculate the post-merger EPS. This is nothing but addition of the pre-merger earnings of both the companies divided by the total number of shares, which is 4 lakh of A Limited plus 50,000, which they are going to issue to B Limited, and therefore the EPS comes out to be rupees 2.78 per share. Last question asked us to calculate what would be the EPS, what would be the exchange ratio in order for the EPS to remain the same. The EPS, if it is to be, if it has to remain the same, the exchange ratio should be in proportion to the EPS, which is 1.25 is to 2.5. If you see, the EPS is 1.25 of B Limited and of A Limited it is 2.5, and therefore the exchange ratio would be 1.25 is to 2.5, which is 0.5 is to 1. The interpretation is that A Limited should issue 0.5 shares for every share held in B Limited. See, I had also done a verification over here just in order not to lose marks, because I thought that this answer is not detailed, and therefore I did a verification to see that post-merger EPS has remained the same as pre-merger EPS. Since the exchange ratio is 0.5 shares, therefore the number of shares to be issued are 0.5 into 2 lakh, which is 1 lakh, and the post-merger EPS comes out to be 10 lakh plus 2,50,000, which is nothing but the addition of pre-merger earnings of both the companies divided by 4 lakh plus 1 lakh, which is 4 lakh existing shares of A Limited plus 1 lakh number of shares to be issued to B Limited, and the EPS comes out to be rupees 2.5 per share, which is equal to the pre-merger EPS of A Limited. Okay, I hope the presentation was clear to all of you. Let's move on to question number 1, part B. B Limited is contemplating to borrow an amount of rupees 50 crores for a period of 3 months in coming 6 months time from now. The current rate of interest is 8% per annum, but it may go up in 6 months time. The company's bankers quoted an FRA of 8.3% per annum. Compute the effect of FRA and the actual rate of interest cost to the company if the actual rate of interest happens to be 8.6% or happens to be 7.8% per annum. Show your workings on the basis of months. This is also very easy. See, B Limited is borrowing an amount of 50 crores, so it entered into a forwarded agreement locking its interest rate at 8.3% per annum. If the interest turns out to be 8.6% per annum, P Limited would gain. Why? Because if it would not have entered into this FRA, it would have had to pay 8.6% per annum, which is the rate prevailing in the market. But since it entered into this FRA, it locked its interest liability to 8.3% per annum only. And therefore, it is going to receive an amount of difference of 0.3% from the bank. Similarly, in the case of 7.8%, it has to pay an amount to the bank, which is nothing but the difference of 8.3% and 7.8% per annum. Let's see the suggested answers, how they have given this answer. First, they have written down the formula. I have lost 4 marks in this particular question, despite the fact that my entire answer was correct, like the suggested answers. But I lost 4 marks. Why? Because I did not write this particular formula and I did not explain the answer in detail. This, you have to write this particular formula which we have discussed in our Unacademy lessons. Okay, I have explained the derivation of this formula there. Simply subtract the interest rate by the FRA rate and multiply it by 3 months period. Discount it by 3 months using the interest rate of the market. This is important. You have to use the prevailing market rate and not the FRA rate. Market rate discount for a period of 3 months. Okay, divide it by 1.0215 to get an amount of 367107. This is the amount which you are going to receive from the bank as a result of entering into the FRA. What is the interest on loan for 3 months at 8.6%? It is 107,50,000, which is nothing but 50 crores into 8.6% into 3/12. Subtract 367107 to get the net amount, and you can compute the effective interest rate for a period of per annum by multiplying it by 12 and dividing it by 3 to get 8.31%. Logically speaking, it should have been exact 8.3%, but due to rounding of error, it is 8.31%. 8.3% is the FRA rate itself. Similarly, we can calculate if the interest rate turns out to be 7.8%. The interest liability is to be added by the amount to be paid to the bank, and therefore the effective interest rate turns out to be 8.29%, which should have been 8.3% exactly. There wouldn't have been any rounding of errors. This is how they have presented in their suggested answers. Let me show you how I had presented in my certified copy, because of which I lost 4 marks. See, the FRA has been entered at 8.3%. If the interest turns out to be 8.6%, the actual interest payable would be 1.075 crores and the FRA receipts would be 0.0375 crores, and therefore the net amount would be 1.0375 crores. Calculating the effective interest for a period of 1 year, it is 8.3% per annum exactly. Okay, I had received only 1 and 1 2 marks, whereas I was supposed to receive 4 marks in this question. I don't know why I did not receive 4 out of 4 marks. I think I did not write that formula, that therefore I lost 4 marks in this question. Similarly, for this particular 7.8% per annum, I computed the actual interest payable for a period of 3 months. I computed the FRA payment for a period of 3 months. I computed the net amount payable, and the effective interest cost was nothing but 8.3% per annum once again. Okay, I hope through this analysis you would now understand that you have to present your answer in detail, and therefore even though my answer was correct of 8.3% per annum, I lost 4 marks in this question just because I did not write that formula and I did not show the detailed working which was expected by the examiner. Let's see what is the theory question. State briefly the basic characteristics of VC financing, venture capitalist financing. Okay, I will just show you how I have written this in the examination. I first wrote the definition of venture capital funds. It funds the startups and new entrepreneurs. Okay, the characteristics are long-term horizon, lack of liquidity, high risk, and equity financing. By writing these keywords and explaining it in your own words would fetch you 4 out of 4 marks, which I was able to fetch in my particular answer sheet. Okay, I just wrote the keywords, I underlined them, and I was able to score 4 out of 4 marks in this question as well. Okay, so for equity financing, they also like to be a part of the management, therefore they are keen in financing through equity and not debt. They take high risk, and because they expect a higher return, there's a lack of liquidity because of higher risk, and they invest for a long-term horizon, which will not be less than 3 years but may extend to 10 years. Okay, this is how I was able to score 4 out of 4 marks. Let's solve the last question. Question number 4. Yeah. Following information is available for Messrs. TS Limited. Profit before interest and tax, profit before tax, PAT, EPS, ratio, market price per share, number of outstanding shares are given. Okay, undistributed reserves of 8 crores are there. The company requires 3 crores for the purpose of expansion. If the debt to capital employed ratio is higher than 35%, the P ratio is expected to decline to 8 times and the rise in the cost of additional debt to 14%. Given this information, what should the company prefer and why? If the required amount is raised through debt and if the required amount is raised through equity, and the new share will be issued at a price of 25 each. Let me show you the suggested answers. I lost 5 marks in this particular question. Again, I'll tell you why I lost 5 marks in this question. Okay. Let's see the suggested answers first. Calculation of ROC. The capital employed is to be computed first. The share capital is of 40. The number of shares are 40 lakhs and the price is rupees 10. So 4 crores is the share capital. Undistributed reserves are of 8 crores and the amount of debt can be computed by dividing the interest by the interest rate, which is 10%. 1 crore upon 10% gives me the debt and the total capital employed is 22 crores. Since the profit before interest and tax was 5 crores, the return on capital employed is 22.73%. This is a mistake which I made in my certified copy answers. The existing capital employed is 22, but they need an additional funding of 3 crores. Therefore, the revised capital employed becomes 25 CR. I had to multiply 25 CR by 22.73% to get the revised profit before interest and tax. This step I missed out. I assumed that the profit before interest and tax would remain the same, and therefore I lost 5 marks only because of this particular mistake itself. Because profit before interest and tax is the starting point for both the answers. Let's compute the new debt to equity ratio. In option 1, the debt would become 13, the total capital would become 25. It is more than 35%, therefore the P ratio would reduce to 8 times. In option 2, the debt would be 10, the capital is 25, debt to capital is more than 35%. Once again, the P ratio would reduce to 8 times. Okay, let's calculate the market price per share in both the options. Whichever has a higher market price, I have to choose that particular option. See, I had to start with revised profit before interest and tax. This is the mistake which I had made in my answer sheet. I started it 5 crores itself and I lost 5 marks despite the fact that my interest was correct. My tax was of course incorrect because of incorrect PBT. My number of shares outstanding were correct, but still I lost 5 marks only because of this one small error. So remember, you have to be very careful. in order to start any particular answer, the starting point should always remain accurate in order to score good marks. Okay. Funds to be raised are 3 crores under option 2. They are going to be issued at rupees 25 per share. Therefore, the additional shares to be issued are rupees 12 lakhs. The interest is computed over here as existing 1 crore plus 3 crores into 14%. So, 1.42 is what? 1 crore existing plus 3 crores into 14% is the additional cost of debt. You get the PBT, subtract tax to get the PAT, divide by number of shares outstanding, which is 40 and 52 lakhs. 52 is what? 40 plus 12. And 12 is nothing. Okay. Once we have calculated this, we get the EPS multiplied by the P ratio, which is the same, to get the market price. Okay. Option 1 would be preferable because it has a higher market price. I would just show you what error I made in my answer sheet. Debt to capital employed ratio was 52%, which was correct. Value of debt at present is 10 crore. Value of equity is 12 crores. Okay. The P ratio would be 8 times because the debt to capital employed ratio is more than 35%. See, this was the error, 5 crores, which I had made. PBIT is not 5 crores. Despite the fact that my interest amount is correct, if you see this 1 and 0.42 is correct, profit after tax is incorrect, 40 lakhs is correct, P ratio is correct. Despite all these correct workings, I did not even score a single 0. Zero. Why? Because the starting point of PBIT is only incorrect. I had to multiply the ROC by the revised capital employed to get the revised profit before interest and tax. And in spite of the fact that I was able to compute the market price, the understanding of my question was correct. The only error which I made was in computing the revised profit before interest and tax. In option 2, I computed the revised debt to capital employed ratio, which is 40%. Therefore, the P ratio is 8 times. Again, there is an error which I made, which is PAT of 3 crores. This should have been the revised PBIT minus interest minus tax to get the revised profit after tax. Okay. The number of shares were also correct, 0.52 crores, which is 0.4 plus 0.12 crores. The P ratio was also correct, which is 8 times, but still I lost 1 or 2 marks in this sub question as well. So I lost 5 marks in this particular question, despite the fact that my understanding was correct only because of a small error of not computing the revised profit before interest and tax. I hope you can now understand how tricky and how important it is for all of you to compute the starting point accurately to score good marks. Let's move on to question number 4B, which is a forex question. This is also a relatively easier question. Okay. There is a unit A Limited, which is a manufacturing cum exporting unit. It exports to Japan, US and Europe on 90 days credit period. The rates are given, the export sale price per unit is given, variable cost per unit is given, receipts is given, and the 3 months forward, 3 months spot and spot market rates are given. Okay, these rates are given for Japan, USA and Europe. We have to advise the company by calculating average CS ratio whether it should hedge its currency risk or not. Okay, we can advise the company by calculating the average contribution to sales ratio whether it should hedge its currency risk or not. I would just show you my certified copy. I have written exactly the same as they have written, and I was able to score 8 out of 8 marks in this question as well. See, the export price is given. This is in Japanese yen, this is in dollars, this is in euro. I did not write yen, euro, dollar and euro, still I scored 8 on 8 marks. I divided by the price per unit to get the number of units. I needed this in order to compute the variable cost, because the variable cost was given in per unit terms. In order to calculate the variable cost, I needed it to multiply by the number of units. If hedging is done, what would happen? I would divide sales by the 3 months forward rate. This is the crux. We have to divide by the 3 months forward rate. Understand, A Limited is a manufacturing cum exporting unit. Therefore, it is going to receive Japanese yen, US dollar and euros. Since it would receive yen, it has to sell yen in order to receive rupees. This is the rate of rupees. Okay, this is the rate of rupees. Since we have to sell yen, we have to buy rupees. Since we are going to buy rupee, bank is going to sell the rupees, and therefore it would sell at a higher rate, which is the offer rate. 2.427, 0.0216 and 0.0178 respectively. Okay, we have to simply divide the receipts by these rates, and therefore we can get the sales. Subtract the variable cost, which is nothing but number of units multiplied by the variable cost per unit to get the total contribution. Add this, divide by the total sales to get the average contribution to sales ratio. If hedging is not done, what would be the average contribution to sales ratio? We simply have to divide the sales by the 3 month spot rate now. Since we are not hedging, we would divide it by the 3 month spot rate, which is 2.459, 0.02156 and 0.0179 respectively. If you see, I did not even divide this by the, like I divided it by the rates, but I did not show the calculations because I was lacking some time. I was short of time and therefore I did not divide it, but still I was able to score 8 out of 8 marks. So I computed the total sales, I subtracted the variable cost. This we have already computed in the earlier subpart. This is the total of all these three. And I calculated the revised contribution to sales ratio, which is 19.17%. And I wrote the conclusion: the company should hedge the currency risk as the average CS ratio is higher if it hedges the currency. Okay, remember there is one mark for the conclusion as well. So highlight this particular conclusion, and I think you should be able to score good marks if you are able to present your answer neatly and with full clarity and conciseness. Let's solve the next and the last sub question which I had attempted. This is the module question once again. Investment shares is given of ABC and XYZ Limited, daily standard deviation is given, correlation coefficient is given, which is 0.3. We are required to determine the 10 days 99% value at risk. The z-score is given as 2.33. This is very simple. One mistake which students tend to make here is that they tend to multiply the weights while calculating the portfolio standard deviation. This is very important. First, compute the daily standard deviation, which is what, 200 lakh into 1%, which is rupees 2 lakh. Since we have computed the daily standard deviation in rupees terms, have already incorporated the weights while we have computed the daily standard deviation, and therefore we are not required to multiply the weights separately over here. The formula of portfolio standard deviation is what? Weight square 1 sigma square 1 plus weight square 2 sigma square 2 plus 2 weight 1 weight 2 sigma 1 sigma 2 into correlation coefficient. But we don't have to multiply by weights separately because we have taken rupee value of standard deviation and the weights have been incorporated separately. We get the portfolio standard deviation as root to 10.4, which is 3.2249 lakhs. This is the daily standard deviation. Okay, this is daily. We have to multiply by root 10 in order to compute the 10 day standard deviation, which is 10.1980 lakhs. Simply multiply this by the z score to get the 10 days value at risk, which is 2.33 into 10.198, which is 23.7614 lakhs. Most of my friends lost marks in this question because they had multiplied by the weights and therefore they were not able to score 4 out of 4 marks which I was able to score in this question. I hope the analysis of my certified copies was useful for all of you. I hope this session helps all of you to present your answers in a neat and cleaner manner, and I hope that you have now got a clarity in terms of presenting the theoretical as well as practical answers separately in your SFM paper. I hope this session is useful for all of you. Stay safe, take care. And I would be uploading more videos soon based on my availability and based on the requirements which all of you want. Okay, thank you so much for watching this. Stay safe.